A very good morning to all. I am Mansi Trivedi, Assistant Professor in Parallel Institute of Physiotherapy, welcomes you all. In the current scenario of evidence-based practice and advanced therapy in pediatric as well as neurophysiotherapy, we all physiotherapists are seeking for the expert to train us. Okay. So today we have with us Dr. Manthan, who has done his Master of Physiotherapy in Neuromuscular Disorder, and he is currently working as a pediatric physiotherapist and aquatic physiotherapist at Aquacentric Therapy Mumbai, where he is playing an important role in aquatic therapy for pediatric as well as neurological rehabilitation. So, Dr. Manthan, we are very delighted and proud to have you with us. And please share your knowledge and the experience with us on aquatic therapy. Thank you. Please, Dr. Manthan, proceed.
Thank you so much, Dr. Mansi, for a warm welcome. And yes, I would like to also thank Dr. Chaitali ma'am for giving me this opportunity and Physiotherapy Department of Parallel University. Today's topic is aquatic therapy, and I'm trying to give you a gist of what aquatic therapy, how aquatic therapy can be used as a tool for a pediatric and neurological rehabilitation. And here I would like to request all the viewers that whatever the videos and photographs I'm using, that is, we have that exclusive permission to use it for the webinar. So just don't use it any further for without informing us priorly. And learning objective for today is I'm going to give you a fundamentals of aquatic therapy. What is aquatic therapy? What are the properties of water? Aquatic therapy techniques. So what are the different techniques which is used for management of pediatric and neurological conditions? As well as we'll go for a therapeutic benefits. At last, we'll have one case presentation of spastic diaplegic cerebral palsy child. So all of you might be having a question that what is aquatic therapy? So aquatic therapy as a term, treatment or exercises which can be provided in a water environment and for the purpose of physical rehabilitation or fitness or relaxation or for other therapeutic benefits. Personally, I am dealing with physical rehabilitation where I treat various neurological and pediatric conditions in a therapeutic pool. Second question which pops up, that is why aquatic therapy, why it should be incorporated into the process of rehabilitation. So here you can see our center called as Aquacentric Physiotherapy Center. Here we have a medical gymnasium. This is outdoor area and this is therapeutic pool. So why all these three components has to be incorporated? Because when a person, as in like a footballer, a pediatric footballer, I'm training, he needs this medical gymnasium for muscle strengthening, for range of motion exercises, which we are quite habituated, which is conventional physiotherapy, strengthening, stretching, everything. Then there is an outdoor component to it, as in like a same example, a footballer trying to achieve his goals of playing on the field. If I don't have that area to manage him, to train him, then he is in an enclosed space, he's not going to work it out for him. So here we have a lawn as well as obstacle training, which is very useful for spinal cord patients, stroke patients, cerebral palsy, for training them and giving them that external environment training, which they need in their daily routine. And we can make this as a functional. And why aquatic therapy? Because here too, the mechanism, the physics law of exercise is going to be similar. We are practicing, we are doing exercises against the gravity, whereas here it provides, aquatic therapy provides a completely different environment itself to do the exercises. And that's why aquatic therapy was incorporated primarily along with the outdoor as well as indoor centers, indoor setups. How do we achieve it? What are the reasons that we get this improvement, we get this environment to practice aquatic therapy? So there are a few physical properties of water like buoyancy, viscosity, hydrostatic pressure, and therapeutic warmth. I'm going to specify this in terms of only a pediatric and neurological aspect. So what is buoyancy? Buoyancy, this is very basic, as in like if I explain in simple words, it is basically a weightlessness which you feel when you enter into the water. There is a feeling of up thrust, that water is pushing you up. and that is completely contrasting to gravity, which we are habituated with. Even NASA is training their astronauts underwater because it imitates that feeling of weightlessness or gravityless feeling. And that is very, very important for a pediatric and neurological rehabilitation, because what we are trying ultimately is to facilitate movement. And this buoyancy allows us, because movement takes less effort to perform in the children's and adults in neurological condition, can learn movement easily inside the water environment. Even it reduces the joint loading, especially in stroke patients when they have associated knee pain in the affected side or unaffected side. In Parkinsonism cases, I have a bad case of Parkinson along with a very bad knee arthritis, and a water environment offloads the joint because of this buoyancy and allows them to perform the movement better, allow me to stretch them better without any pain. So that's the beauty of buoyancy. When we move forward to hydrostatic pressure, how it is important, as in like the person is standing just below the knee joint, the pressure exerted by the water on a body surface is going to be 15%. Whereas when we move forward up to the neck level, it is increased up to 90%. So here my common practice for adults is usually varying from 50% to 75%. Again, it will depend on what I need, especially into them. When the pressure is exerted onto the body, it improves the proprioception as well as the coordination. So it add on provides that sensory input which we need for a motor outcome. So that's why hydrostatic pressure is very, very important, especially there are subacute stroke, those who are having problems with the edema. So that also can be resolved because the water, the pressure which is exerted by the water on the body pushes the fluid to go up back towards the heart. So that's how also it is very important to have the hydrostatic pressure. Viscosity is basically the air is less viscous than the water. It is the resistance which is provided by the water. How it is going to be different, as in like if you can see here in the picture, this case of a neurological condition is rolling a ball, and when he is trying to get it forward and backward, that is a truncal facilitation, or when he is trying to just hold it in a place by pushing it down into the water, that holding itself activates the finger flexors and extensors, as well as the wrist and the shoulder muscles, as well as the scapular stabilizers. So that is the different as compared to when you give the weight in the land, they'll not be able to hold it, and there is only activation of the up to the shoulder. Whereas here, by holding the ball, it also activates the upper arm scapular stabilizers, as well as truncal patterns, as well as limbs. So when you try, just feel that when you are into the water and you try to push the ball filled with air inside, automatically you'll feel unstable because the weight which you're carrying travels from your point of contact till your great toe, because that is in contact with the floor. So that's how that stability, add-on stability, provides us opportunity to work on a dynamic strengthening, which is very much needed. And also it is very important that it allows us to work on a balance and coordination, because many of the cases of neurological conditions, they need a balance training, coordination training. And when the person is standing inside the water, there is less chances of injury. Because if you're falling, again, that viscosity of the fluid is going to stop or cease the movement or slow down the movement. And that is going to help to prevent any further injury. Turbulence. And kids love this turbulence because it gives that massaging effect onto the body, and it adds on more of a pain relief component, especially for stroke. I'm relating it more of to a stroke and cerebral palsy, so you can understand it easily. Those who are having shoulder pain, when that massaging effect comes off the water, we have that jet spray which can come from here and it can go forward. Here you can see in this example that the child is holding the noodle, and here I'm trying to activate the scapular stabilizers, and when I add on that turbulence like a wave which is coming in the sea, when I activate that, automatically the child is trying to control the balance, and that gives me the dynamic strengthening of the truncal muscle which is needed for standing and walking as well. And there are different modes of, there are different grades of resistance which I can provide by using turbulence. Therapeutic warmth, very, very important, that here you can see the therapeutic pool, and the temperature of the pool is around 32 to 35 degrees depending on the neurological condition. There are few neurological conditions, especially like multiple sclerosis, in which I cannot allow temperature more than around 29 to 30 degrees centigrade. But for all other conditions, pediatric and neurological conditions, usual common temperature is varying from 32 to 35 degrees, because it is very important to have that feeling of acceptance. When you enter into the cold water, there is a resistance to it. There is a sudden closure of the muscle. Whereas when you enter into the warm, it is more warm water. It is more accepting. It is more of accepted by your body, as well as you can get habituated with it very easily. That's why we have to, the therapeutic pool has to have a warm temperature, and how it aids pain relief. So here I would like to see, we all know about gait control theory. Here you can see all of our different muscle fibers going up towards the brain. And provides that pain sensation due to maybe a shoulder pain or a knee pain in stroke cases or a Parkinson cases. When the fibers are going up, it provides that pain sensation. But when the person enters into the pool, there is a buoyancy which reduces the joint loading, as well as the hydrostatic pressure, which provides the add-on sensation of a pressure of a warm temperature which is provided, and that doesn't allow this pain sensation, as in like this girl is a pain fiber, it doesn't allow that pain sensation to go up towards the brain, and that's how it adds on the pain relief, especially in a warm pool which is therapeutic in nature. This is a picture of gait control theory. Which condition should be managed by aquatic therapy? So there are a few, almost all the conditions can be managed by aquatic therapy, but there are few conditions which is exclusively giving us best results, as in like a multiple sclerosis or a muscular dystrophy, in which the land exercise is very, very difficult to perform. They feel relaxed when they enter into the water, and exercise as in component becomes much more easy for them, as in like a Parkinson, when they have that rigidity because of the water temperature and the warmth, the muscle usually opens up, and that allows the better performance in water. Those cases, we have one good case of AVN of hip, and that necrosis doesn't allow that weight bearing on the lamb, because the weight which is going to get through the hips to the knee and to the ankle, that promotes that pain. But when they enter into the water, because of the offloading at the hip joint and because of the weightlessness, when I'm asking the patient to walk up to walk with the 75% up to chest level water, the weight is automatically reduced. So in that case, early rehabilitation can be started by utilizing aquatic therapy. What are the benefits of aquatic therapy? There is a definite improvement in muscle strength and endurance. I've already explained that how strengthening is relatively different as compared to land, and endurance training, especially because of the viscosity. In simple, walking itself inside the therapeutic pool for a stroke patient or a cerebral palsy patient, it promotes that muscle endurance training which is needed for them into their daily routine while they are walking on land. Improvement in flexibility and range of motion. It is blessing for me to work in an aquatic environment, because I can mobilize the patient the way I want to by utilizing a different techniques, which we are going to see in a further presentation. And that helps me to get a better flexibility, and better flexibility allows me to have a better function on the land. Protects against the injury, like a balance training or muscular dystrophic cases where strengthening the muscle can be troublesome. In that case, the aquatic is going to be the best environment. Walking made easier due to water properties, as the person is immersed into the water, because of that weightlessness, person starts immediately walking, and the walking itself becomes much more easier to perform inside water because of the water properties. Facilitation of the somatosensory system, and I personally believe that, and it is supported by the evidence as well, that when we move forward to perform when we are trying to learn any movement, if we provide proper sensory input, the motor outcome is going to be better. So when we are performing like PNF technique, we are providing tactile feedback, we are providing verbal feedback. So all that feedback which we are providing is going to give us better motor learning. And when the person is practicing aquatic therapy into the water, when they are moving their limb, automatically they know up to what range they are moving because of the viscosity. When they are moving, they can feel the water, and that's how that sensory input helps me to get a better motor outcome. aquatic environment is motivating for the children, and children loves water. Especially there are only few cases I've seen of hydrophobia, as especially they have like a phobia, proper phobia of water. Entering into water itself is so so completely, it is because it is completely different environment, especially those who are having sensory issue like autism. Entering into water is very difficult for them. But I think so within two or three sessions, we got the opportunity to stabilize them, and they completely forgot about their phobia and they are enjoying water like anything. So that's how water itself is a motivating medium for exercise to perform. Moving forward to red flags and yellow flags, these are not a complete list, but these are common which we go through in the special neurological and pediatric perspective. Red flags are completely no-no, which is like contagious disease, any related to skin condition, open wound. If it is small open wound, we can cover it with waterproof dressing, but it needs a further evaluation. Uncontrolled seizures, where we get that frequent seizures and it is very difficult to deal, then we usually don't allow. Acute vomiting or diarrhea, especially pediatric or neurological population, is shortness of breath, address. Any simple physical activity which can promote breathlessness, we usually avoid taking them inside the pool. And as you can see, this is very relatively simpler, as in there is no specific contraindication to aquatic therapy. And yellow flags are especially kids, those who are having bladder and bowel incontinence, sensitivity to disinfectant or chemical, especially like chlorine, or those who are having hydrophobia, we need to provide them mental adjustment and then we can start with aquatic therapy. Or any open with occlusive dressing, we need to provide that. I told you about the waterproof dressing, which we can do, and then we can take them inside the water. So these are simple red flags, yellow flags for the pediatric and neurological perspective. We'll go through, this is the last fundamental, I think, so regarding equipment which we use. So as a neuro perspective, I use a different equipment, like a noodle, which is very simple to use, or for a pediatric population, like a racket and a ball to promote strengthening. This is a case of Down syndrome. Here they are playing along with the dish and collecting the toys, so to make them socially integrated, especially in the autism, those who are having sensory issue, communication issues. And for a pediatric population, I use whatever I get, because it will completely depend on the need of the child. The primary target of me as a therapist is to promote and engage and get the goals out of the child. So whatever equipment which I can use, there are specific equipment which we use for aquatic therapy, but for kids, whatever in whatever equipment they have interest, I use it for the rehabilitation. That is the best strategy, as according to me. This is the first primary criteria, that you should have a therapeutic pool to perform. This is a mechanical lift, which is very helpful for the cases, those who are having a wheelchair. Here you can see, this is the changing area which is necessary, and the shower before and after entering into the pool, you should get a proper shower. Also, we usually do vital checks before and after the session, which is very important. After that, equipment in terms of foam dumbbells, this is very helpful for a stroke patient where they are folding, and because of the flotation, automatically the dumbbell comes up, and that gives me a good range at the shoulder as well as a good mobility and movement at the shoulder level. Pins and flippers, kids love this, because when I give them, automatically there is a resistance. So when they are doing a bilateral kicking movement, like a spastic cerebral palsy child, automatically I get a better facilitation, because movement is already facilitated. And with pins and flippers, extensor control is going to be much better. Even there is one good strategy which we use with the slipper is in stroke patient. We provide the fins and flippers into the unaffected, non-affected extremity. And when we ask the patient to walk, automatically there is increased loading because of the water resistance of the flipper. There is an increased loading, there is increasing resistance on non-affected swing face. So automatically there is a loading on the affected side. So that is a very good strategy, which is very helpful in so patients to give more weight on the affected side, to get that transition from unaffected to affected extremity for a case. Flotation belts and float cuffs are usually used for adult neuro cases, where we are practicing the technique called as BRRM. It provides them that flotation which they need with the neck collar and this flotation belt. Automatically they are offloaded into the water in a verticality. Kickboards, again, we use it for strengthening, for swim-based activities. Here we have a neck collar, especially used for a technique called BRRM. With this neck float and this flotation belt, if I leave the patient completely, the patient will be able to float without any add-on assistance. And then we can work on a movement. Like here you can see they are working on a shoulder. Then we can work on a trunk. So I will go through a different strategies later on. These are the resistant boots and these are the resistant paddles again used for to provide add-on resistance while they are performing any movement. Now, moving forward to a specific technique, what we use, what are the approaches of aquatic therapy? So my toolkit, I can say, is a water-specific therapy. A water-specific therapy is basically, you can say, exercise therapy for water, Bhadraga's ring method, Aichi treadmill, Watsu, as well as aquatic play-based intervention. I will go through each water-specific therapy. It was founded by James Macmillan around 1940s, 1950s, based on Hollerith concept. How this concept of WSC came, as in like, it can give you that how to take the child as well as to up to reaching to how the comfortable, according to the comfort of the child, you can even teach swim-based movement. So what should be the progression that was given by the Hollerith concept? And here you can see there is a 10-point program of Hollerith concept. The mental adjustment, as in like simple starting, as in like the child is facing me, and I'm asking the child to blow the balloon in the water. So that gives me mental adjustment. And second comes the disengagement, in which I ask the child to face the open environment. So in a slow programmed manner, I can take the child inside the pool and perform various exercises, as in like this is a transversal rotational control, similar to what we have learned in Dina Gardner about flexion, extension, abduction. It relatively similar concept is over here, that transverse rotational control, sagittal rotational control, longitudinal control. Then we move forward to a higher grade, and at last we can teach them basic swimming movement of a different shoulder and leg stroke. And primarily mental adjustment and disengagement, it is primary I use on a first session to get them inside the pool, to make them comfortable inside the pool. So here you can see one strategy of which we are working on in radical patient. Here you can see the therapist is holding the leg of the child, and the therapist, you feel that the loading is going to be there on the therapist, but it is completely offloaded because of the water properties. I don't feel any weight of the patient. And here the client can, the patient can easily do crunches, can come forward, go back. Here we are working on the ranges of the side flexion of the trunk, lateral flexion of the trunk. And the movement can be learned very easily because you can feel the resistance of the water. Here you can see the child is on a mattress which is floating on the water, and the child is half immersed inside the pool, half is out of the pool, and weight bearing is completely there on the right side. And the child is actively engaged into the pool. So here you can see the mat itself is floating because it's moving completely. So that adds on the dynamic component to it, as well as the ring on which the child is placing this, that is also moving. So the target is also moving, and the surface itself is moving. So that's how it can provide that add-on balance. And usually there is less chances of fall, but if there is anything happening, the child will fall inside the pool. So there is no injury because of the water. And I'll tell you that kids love falling inside the water more than learning about all these techniques. And we have to control them. Okay, let's do 10 and then we'll fall for one time. So that's how they love water as a medium for exercises. This will be evidence-based practice slide. Here you can see how water-specific therapy can be used for active trunk recovery. And the conclusion was that it allows, we get that short-term benefit which we need for the transition on the length, and it can promote that trunk extension of the whole spine in cerebral palsy cases. And this was for subacute stroke patients, effect of aquatic therapy, Hollerith therapy on a functional mobility. And it was well tolerated by all stroke patients post-acute recovery. And there is a positive effect on mobility as well. Bhadraga's ring method, this is the second technique. This is not a proper PNF, but this is based on PNF. And I can say that here we work on a similar principle where we provide the tactile feedback, we provide the verbal feedback, we provide the sensory feedback to get the better motor outcome. And it's a water-based technique. So there are techniques in which you can facilitate the arm. There are leg patterns, there are arm patterns similar to what we have on the PNF, and also there is flow reversal, and every technique is relatively similar, but the perform very differently. Here I'm showing you two different techniques of leg strengthening. Here you can see the child is the adult is performing unilateral leg strengthening, while the patient has to push for the knee. And here we are working on a bilateral strengthening. We have a specific hold for the leg, and the patient has to perform a bilateral movement of the leg. And here you can see the as compared to PNF, I can see water provides that different sensory feedback, and the even if you ask patient, they can feel the movement better in terms of, because of the sensory feedback, okay, I'm doing this rain, I'm performing a better repetition, so that they can feel and give us a proper feedback. And it is not stressful for me as well because of this ring, which is called as the tie ring, as well as the neck float, which allows that flotation with the patient. And what is the effect of Bhadraga straightening, especially in stroke patients? We need that tibial is anterior work for push off and then heel stride, and we got positive and